All right. Well, good morning and welcome to worship here at the Bloomer United Methodist Church. How's everybody doing?
Good.
All right. I like the sound of that. Well, I am excited for our time to be together, to worship, to draw closer to God, and to be with each other. If you're joining us online, welcome. We're glad that you have taken time to be with us, or even if you're watching a recorded version of this message, we are glad that you have found time to come and to worship with us in that way. Friends, as we begin our worship this morning, as we normally do, I'm going to invite us just to take a moment to calm and center ourselves and to really focus upon the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place this morning. Wow. Friends, I invite you to hear these centering words. Repent and draw near to God, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Friends, let us continue this morning with our opening songs. The first one is Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart. It is number 500 in your hymnal. We will sing verses 1 and 5, or the words will also be on the screen. I invite you to stand if you can comfortably do so.
Number 398 in the hymnal, verses 1 and 2.
Join me in prayer. Almighty and loving God, we thank you and we praise you for this day. We thank you for drawing each and every one to this place at this time that we might praise, worship, and glorify you through every aspect of our worship. And Lord, we pray that you would continue to draw us and connect us more deeply together as we go through this life. Lord, we thank you and just ask that your Spirit would move through this space this morning, that the Spirit will touch us, move us, and guide us to hear your truth and empower us to go out and to do the ministry that you have called us to do. Lord, we ask these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated this morning. So a couple of quick announcements for you. The first, obviously, is the list of online resources that are available to and for each of you. So if you're ever not able to be here in person, you can catch a live stream at this time, or you can watch a recorded version on the YouTube app. And then also, we have a couple of social media apps that we utilize to share what's going on in the life and ministry of the church, or to try to give you some devotional and educational opportunities. So we invite you to utilize those, engage with those, and share those as you see fit. Friends, there's a couple of things on your announcement sheet this morning that I want to draw to your attention. The first one is lay leadership following the service. So if you're part of that group, we'll meet at Bohemian Ovens and we will continue our work on discipleship. The second one is the Plarn Making Party, which is on April 12th. There is a time correction there, and that should be from 1 until 2:30 at the New Auburn Church. If you're not sure what a plarn or what plarn making is, it's the taking of plastic bags and making them into yarn, and we actually have a loom that we're going to create mats for homeless people out of. So if you've noticed by the doors, there has been some boxes and things that says bring your used grocery bags and plastic bags in, and we'll put them to good use. And so that's what that will be for. And so again, if you have some extra plastic bags, my wife, please bring them over to the church. All right, please bring them over to the church and donate those so that we can put those to good use. But just please pay attention to that time change, and it begins at 1 o'clock at the New Auburn Church, and we'll go until 2:30. And then the next item on the list is the Bible Cover to Cover group, which is scheduled to meet on April 14th. I believe we are a go for that, so I'm glad that I kept that tentative at New Auburn. So that group will continue. Just we have had to find some alternative leadership for that day, as many of the people that are used to leading that will be going down to Dallas to the Actually Fear Into Faith conference, but I'm glad that we are still able. So that one is still good, and so if you're planning to come and be a part of that, I look forward to that and to what God does through that group. Friends, for those of you online this morning, just a reminder that we are going to be having the Sacrament of Communion again, and so if you would like to take a couple of moments and prepare the elements, I invite you to do that. All right. Oh. All right. Well, thank you for that announcement. So again, if you are attending the Fear and the Faith, either virtually or actually going there, we just ask God's blessing upon you and what he will do with that. If you do have any questions, feel free to talk to my mom or to Sarah after the service. All right, friends. Well, let us continue this morning with our young disciples. Can I have all you guys and girls come up here this morning? All right, so how are all you guys doing this morning? Good. Good? All right, so I got a question for you like I normally do. So what's your, now this, yeah, you need to pay attention. What's your favorite subject in school? So no recess. All right, that's not a subject, okay? So what's your favorite subject that you get to study in school, or who's your favorite teacher? Writing, okay.
Science.
Evie, what do you got?
Sarah.
Oh, the daycare lady is okay. So she's a teacher. All right, that makes sense.
Math.
Math.
My favorite teacher, Miss Freenock.
How do you say it?
Miss Freenock.
Miss Freenock, okay.
Mrs.
Haynes. Mrs. Haney.
Miss Dahmer.
Miss Dahmer. Miss Lang, all right. So already you guys have things that you're interested in. You really like certain subjects, maybe because you're good at them or you just enjoy to do them. Or maybe you've had some really good teachers that have inspired you to enjoy those subjects, right? Because their passion and their ability to teach those subjects make it so that you can be excited about learning and doing those things. Now, do any of you ever get kind of frustrated with school and some of the classes you have to take?
Yep.
Right? There's just some of those classes that we don't really like, right? And we have to take them. But we have to remember that the school's job is to expose us to as many different subjects as possible so that we can find the things that we're good at, right? And to find the things that we do. And already some of you have named some of those things that you like to do, writing and math. All right, and science, okay? And those are good and those are fun subjects, okay? So now, I want to ask you another question. Have you ever thought about Jesus as a teacher? Okay, some of you have, some of you haven't, okay? So what do you make of this book that we have right here? What book is this? The Holy Bible, right? The Holy Bible, right? So this is God's word to us, right? And as we get to the later parts, right, we learn a whole lot about this person named Jesus. And Jesus, I think, is probably the best teacher that you and I will ever have, okay? Because he doesn't just teach us about subjects like math and science and different things, although sometimes he touches on some of those things. But he teaches us how to live our life. And he tells us that if we would do certain things and follow some of the instructions that he gives, we would get to have what he calls the abundant life. He would get to have a good life. Now, that doesn't mean when I say good and abundant life, that doesn't mean that just because we try to follow those instructions that everything in life is easy, right? Sometimes we're still going to struggle. Sometimes things in life will still be hard. But overall, life will be good for us, okay? Because we are growing close to God, all right? So we're going to talk about some of Jesus's teachings over the next several weeks, and I'm going to invite you to see what kind of a teacher you think Jesus is, okay? Do you think he's going to be a good teacher? Right? He's going to be a church teacher, right? He's going to teach us how to live our life to the best that we can. But do you think all of his teachings are going to be easy?
No,
because sometimes he really makes us wrestle with some tough stuff. Like when you get in a fight with your brother and sister or your mom and dad, do you get to sit in that anger? No, you don't, because guess what Jesus says? He says, if you're mad at your brother and sister, it's like you commit murder in your heart. That's kind of a tough charge, right? That's a tough teaching, okay? So Jesus says, look, we don't want that anger to stay in our hearts. We want to get that anger out, and we want to go forgive our brother and sister or forgive our mom and dad or whoever we got in a fight with, okay? So I hope that you guys will pay attention and let's see how good of a teacher Jesus can be over the next few weeks, all right? Can we do that? All right, let me pray for you guys and then you can go have a seat. So dear Jesus, we just thank you so much for our young disciples and we thank you for how much they are growing in their faith. Lord, we just pray that beginning this week and through the next several weeks to follow, that you will just show us what a great teacher you can be. And so, Lord, help us to be willing to have open hearts and open minds to hear your teachings and really try to apply them to our lives. Lord, bless these young disciples and all that they have to do throughout this week. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, you guys can go back and have a seat. Well, friends, let us continue our worship this morning with the giving of our tithes and our offerings. And I'm going to invite some of the acolytes to come back up and to help me out. I'm also going to extend the invitation that if you are worshiping with us online, that you are able to give online, or if you feel more comfortable, you can always mail in a check to the church, and we will receive that into our offering. So please know that there are those options as well. As we sing our doxology together. Almighty and loving God, we thank you and praise you for these tithes and these offerings. And Lord, as we always do, we ask that these would go out into your kingdom, that they would be used to share your gospel message of your love, forgiveness, redemption, and salvation, and that they would also go out to care for those that are in need. So Lord, bless and grow these, and bless the hearts of each and every one of the givers. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, you may be seated. Once again, all right, friends. So, if you could go and study any subject you wanted under any teacher, what subject would it be, and who would be your teacher? This isn't rhetorical. Okay, I'm interested. If you could study anything, what would it be, and would there be someone that you would like to learn under? Okay, so you would keep the same teacher. Is there anything special you would have her teach you? Okay, so English. All right, so good. Well, guess, say that louder for me, bud. Quantum physics. Woo! All right. Well, you gotta, I'm trying to think. That Neil deGrasse Tyson, is that his name? I think that's his name. He's pretty good at teaching astrophysics, right? So he's pretty good at being able to distill all of that big brainiac stuff down so people can understand it. So cool. Why would you study that? The secrets of the universe. Nice. I like that. What about the rest of you? Okay, Jesus. Okay, why would you want Jesus to be your teacher? Right, okay, fair enough. Clay, what do you got, bud?
My mom to be my teacher.
Oh, all right. And what would you have her teach you? Science? Nice. All right. Well, friends, I encourage us to think about those things today, because in the world today, we have more opportunities to learn and to learn from a greater variety of people than at any time in history, right? At no time in history prior to this point have there been as many books, as many online digital resources, and nor have you had access to the wide amount of teachers that are available today, right? And what's interesting is that people will go out of their way to be trained and to be taught by certain people, right? And it's pretty amazing the amount of time and energy. I mean, people will travel over the world to go see people. People will pay tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars to go and study and to learn under someone that they think has what they want to learn or can give them some of the ideas they think they need for success. Now, friends, I don't know if you're aware of the MasterClass platform, but near the beginning of COVID, there was this movement that brought together all of these experts or people that were successful in different fields and different areas of study. And what they did is they digitalized or brought these teachers together, and you can take courses from some of the best in any industry. All right. And so in that spirit, I thought, what might it look like if we had a master class? But unfortunately, I'm not the expert. But what if we looked at, as David suggested, Jesus as our master teacher? And what does it look like for us to have a master class on what the good life looks like? All right. So many of us will agree that that's a pretty big generalization. I think that Jesus is the greatest teacher there ever was. Right? He's given the greatest sermon that's ever been given. And so over the next several weeks, what does it look like to really sit at the feet of Jesus, just as the disciples did on that hill, and listen to how Jesus calls us to live our life? I also think that this series, this master class in the good life by Jesus, will allow us to really pick up where we left off in Lent, where we had to really wrestle with some harder issues. Like, we talked a lot about what it looks like to remove the sin and to try to heal the brokenness we have in our life, right? And so if we've started that process, what does it mean to begin to fill those areas where we've gotten rid of some of the junk that's been bringing us down? And how do we fill that with things that are life-giving? And how is it that we move from that point to continue to grow and be more effective in doing the things that God calls us to do? So we're going to start today in this master class, and we're going to look at the blueprint that Jesus gives us for what it looks like to do ministry in life. And we're also going to look at some of his teachings on what it means to live the good life. Now, like I said, friends, many of the teachings that Jesus offers are going to be tough. Right? They're not just these beautifully little packaged boxes with this bright red bow where we feel all warm and fuzzy inside when he gives some of his teachings, right? Sometimes we really have to wrestle with some of these, and sometimes we have to get rid of ourselves going, you know what, God, I don't really want to do that. I want to be right. I don't think my anger is that big of an issue. I think I know how to handle my finances and the resources I've been given, and I don't need somebody to tell me certain things in those areas. So friends, just as I told the young disciples, let's come together just as those crowds did and just as the disciples did as he delivered this greatest teaching, the greatest sermon ever, and let's hear what Jesus says to us. So friends, today I'm going to start with a passage from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4, verses 17 to 25. So if you want to follow along in your pew Bible or you have a phone app and you want to follow along that way, I invite you to do so. It says, "From that time Jesus began to preach, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near.' As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. 'Come, follow me,' Jesus said, 'and I will send you out to fish for people.' At once they left their nets and they followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. large crowds from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and the region across the Jordan followed him. All right, folks, so let's go down and let's begin to look at this blueprint that Jesus gives us for living life, really. Like, oftentimes we, I think, distinguish what our life should look like compared to what the word ministry should look like. But really, friends, when we look at Jesus' life, ministry and life are interconnected and they overlap. And the call to ministry is, in fact, I think, the call to life. So, it says, from the time that Jesus comes on the scene, right, he just came out of the desert after the tempting in the wilderness by the devil, and he comes on and he begins his ministry, and he's kind of has this one-line sermon that he uses over and over and over again. It's the premise, it's the focus of his ministry on earth, and so he says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Now, friends, that doesn't sound like the most exciting way to reach people, does it? Right? Repent, you sinners, and come back and accept the invitation into heaven. And friends, I would say that this is an important teaching for us because even we as the church have moved away from this beginning message. Right? There's a call not only for the unchurched and the unsaved to repent and come to God, but there's a continuous call for those of us in the church and those of us who are saved to repent. Right? And repentance is not something, as we talked about in our previous series, is not something that's a one and done thing. All right? And sometimes, friends, we'll be amazed at what God uncovers in our heart, sometimes at the most unexpected moments. So let me give you an example. So this week I was sitting down doing my quiet time and I was reading this book and all of a sudden like something in the book just spurred me to sit down and start doing a little bit of journaling. And I started journaling and God really began to convict my heart and said, you know what, you really have a lot of ugly things here in this area of your life. And I had to then at that point kind of quit journaling and go, you know what, God, I didn't even know that stuff was there, but let me get rid of this. Let me repent of this. Let me ask for forgiveness for these things. And friends, I have to tell you, when I did that, I felt about 100 pounds lighter. Like, I didn't even know I had this sin in my heart, and yet because the Holy Spirit convicted me during that quiet time and I asked for repentance, all of a sudden this weight had just been lifted off of my life. Now, friends, you've heard me say a few different times that I often think that our life is like an onion. Right, and that God has this supernatural ability to just kind of pull back the layers. You know, sometimes he pulls back a couple layers at a time and we're like, oh, that hurts, don't do that. And sometimes we think everything's good and all of a sudden he peels back that layer and we find stuff and we're kind of like, wow, I didn't know that was there. But then as we move through that, as we work through that layer that's been brought to the surface, we find that there's transformation, that there's healing in those things. And so, friends, the call to repentance is really important. Now, in the church, we've really kind of moved away from our talk of sin and our talk of repentance, right? Because to talk about repentance means that there's actually right and wrong, right? That there's actually things that you should be doing and things that you shouldn't be doing. In a world where everything has to be inclusive and tolerant, sin and repentance don't fit very well into that narrative. And so often what the church has done in recent decades is go, guess what, everybody? Jesus loves you and Jesus loves you unconditionally. And then we say, go about your life. Well, friends, I can't think really of a worse message to give someone, especially someone who's unsaved, than to say, guess what? God loves you unconditionally and you don't have to change, right? Because that's never the way it is, right? Jesus spent time, he went out of his way to go spend time with sinners and tax collectors and prostitutes, and yet every time he had an encounter with somebody who was far from God, guess what? They moved closer to God and their life changed as a result of that encounter. Jesus didn't say, you know what, I love you, just continue doing what you're doing. Continue to destroy your life and bring death into areas of your life, but I love you, just know that. And yet that's the message that we as the church have decided to give a whole bunch of people. And so, friends, we need to go back to kind of this grassroots and say, look, the call first for us and for other people is repentance, to make sure that our lives and their lives are in alignment with the things that God has for their lives and for our lives. Now, the next thing that Jesus goes on is he talks about the kingdom of heaven. And there's a couple of important things here because some of us go, what in the world does he mean when he says the kingdom of heaven has come near? Well, the first is obvious, right? God has come down, right? Heaven has come down to earth in the person of Jesus Christ. And Jesus, as the king of heaven, begins to usher in a new kingdom here on this earth. Right? And so if you look at the Greek word for kingdom, it means to be ruled by a monarch, right? This idea that people will submit to someone in authority who rules over them. And so we might say that in terms of the kingdom of heaven, that this is a spiritual kingdom, that Jesus is the king of this kingdom, and we submit our lives to his rule. Right? And we do that through submitting our hearts and our lives to the things that he calls us to do. And that is his message. Now, there's also some other implications that as you accept this invitation, as you willingly submit your heart and your life to live in the kingdom, guess what? There's some real benefits. Right? You get forgiveness of your sins. Right? So when you repent, God willingly forgives you because he does love you. Right? And there's nothing that you have done that he's not willing to forgive, but you still need to take the steps to ask for forgiveness. And from there, God begins to redeem all of the broken and the dark places in your life, and he begins to fill those with light, and he begins to transform you from the inside out. And as we live more fully into the kingdom, we become more and more assured of the salvation, the promise of salvation that's available to us when we place our faith in the person of Jesus Christ. But friends, that's not always an easy thing to do, right? Most of us don't like to submit to people, right? We have a hard enough time submitting to the local authorities and stuff we have in our life. Guess what? The speed limit on the highway says 70. Guess, watch this, 72, 75, 85. Let's see how much I can get away with, right? Think about how much in the past few political cycles we have watched almost an anarchy-type movement rise up as there is no desire to submit to the government at all about anything. All right, and so we have a problem submitting to rules because we think that we're our own rulers. All right, but Jesus says, look, you need to submit to my rule. You need to submit your heart and your life to do the things that I have for you. And as you do that, don't be surprised if you find that there are some amazing things that happen as a result. Now, friends, the next thing Jesus does in this blueprint, besides begin to preach and to teach, is he goes out and he looks and he finds followers, right? He follows disciples, right? People who are students, people who are apprentices and will learn to teach and preach the same things that he's doing, as well as to go out and to do the same things that he's doing. And this is a very smart thing on Jesus' part because as one person, there's only so much you can do. Right? Now again, he does have the benefit of being God, and so I'm not going to limit what exactly he can do by himself. But for us that are human, we can only do so much by ourselves. And so I honestly believe we were created to do life together, and so we benefit and life is easier for us when we do things, when we come together in a spirit of unity and connection and teach other people to do the things that we're doing. Right, and that's our call, right? Oftentimes, again, we can distinguish this idea of discipleship and say, well, this is a church thing, but my life over here is different. And it's like, no, there's this interconnection. You're to be discipling as you're living your life. But that might mean, again, that you're submitting to God in that, because if your life at church doesn't look the way your life at home does, it's pretty tough to disciple people in a positive and a healthy way. But Jesus goes out and he calls, I love this about Jesus, he calls some of the most unlikely characters, if you will. And I use characters very pejoratively there, right? Because indeed some of his disciples are true characters, right? Peter is one of a kind, right? You need a little spice in life, guess what? Peter's going to be blunt and he's going to throw it out there for you and the whole world to see, right? Some of us are that same way. We like to spice things up and sometimes we cause a little bit of drama and a little bit of chaos. But the thing that I love about Jesus is that Jesus' invitation is open to each and every one of us. I believe God has a firm calling on each and every one of your lives, whether you're the youngest one here or the oldest one here. God has a purpose and a call for your life, and he will utilize you in the ways that he's planned for you to do your ministry and your life. But friends, even discipleship is a process, right? Because the disciples didn't just sit down and study under Jesus. Jesus didn't give them, all right, here's my Kingdom of Heaven curriculum 101. I'm going to teach this to you for a week, and then I'm sending you out on your own. But friends, how often do we do that in life, right? How often is our educational model flawed where we bring people in and we say, guess what? I'm, as the pastor, going to stand here, and I'm going to teach you the things that I think you should know and then just tell you to go out and do them. And I have been guilty of doing that, so please forgive me. But the call is that not only do I teach you, but I go out with you and show you how to do the things, the ministry, the discipling that goes on in your life. You bring in other people to do stuff. And so this isn't just a short-term process. It's a lifelong process that we go through learning to be more and more like Jesus, to imitate the things that he does. Now, last week during Easter, we talked again about this idea that God goes before us, right? That God is the one who calls us, and we see this right here. Hey, guys, hey, fishermen, come follow me. So this means that, again, Jesus goes before these guys, showing them how to live life, how to do ministry, how to turn their regular fishing skills into the ability and skills to fish for other people. And friends, that's the same call. But now, friends, I want you to take just a really quick moment, because this is where Jesus' teaching gets tough. This is where the blueprint really gets rough for us. Look at verses 20 and 22. Jesus offers this invitation to disciples, right? Come and follow me, and this is what I'll teach you. And in verse 20, what's the response? At once they left. And in verse 22, immediately they left. And what did they leave? Everything. They left their jobs. They left their homes. They left even their family in the case of the later two, right? They left their father out there in the boat saying, guess what? We're committed enough to follow Jesus that we're willing to give up everything to go and follow. How many of us are that willing to give up the things that we have? If Jesus came down right now and said, you know what? I want you to sell your house and the things that you have and follow me, how many of us would do it? If Jesus said, guess what? I'm going to transplant you from Wisconsin to some other place in the world within a short amount of time, how many of us would go? Friends, God has really been working on my heart in this area. I think I'm finally to the point where I could say, yes, I would be willing to go, but it's taken me 45 years before I'm willing to submit to that type of change. But these are the stakes, right? And when God says go, what happens when we go? God blesses us. God opens up opportunity to use us and help us fulfill the purpose that he's given us. But what happens when we don't go? We miss out on the good life. And there's a number of people in the scriptures that are not willing to follow where Jesus wants them to go. And we see time and time again, people come before Jesus and Jesus says, come, follow me. And they say, I can't. I got to go take care of my family. Go sell all your possessions. That's too hard of a thing for me. I've worked my whole life to be where I'm at. I've got to go bury my dead. Let the dead bury themselves. Jesus says, come follow me right now, and I'll show you what it means to live the good life. Friends, again, many of us have become complacent. Many of us are even willing to be disobedient, and that needs to change. Now, I'm not saying in every case that Jesus is going to call us to uproot everything, but if he does, will you be willing to go? Because that's where the good life is. And when we don't follow, we miss out on amazing opportunities. So Jesus's followers are willing to go and to learn. They're willing to give up everything they know to follow this man. And as they go, Jesus begins to teach them about a variety of different things, right? He takes them into the synagogues. He takes them out into the square. He takes them out into public places, and he begins to show them what it means to teach and to preach. And as he does it, he not only teaches and preaches, but he also begins his healing ministry. He begins healing those that are sick with disease. He begins casting out the demons. He begins mending the brokenness in people's lives. And what's the response? People come from all over the region to hear, to listen, to be in his presence, and to experience the healing that he offers. Right? I told you the experience of Jesus going out to the margins, to going out to those that have been left behind. But every time he goes to the sinners, the tax collectors, and the prostitute, that brokenness is transformed into something amazing because they're willing to allow that to happen. But friends, this is tough work. And this is where I think, again, speaking generally, maybe even stereotypically, that the church has failed in recent decades, is that we have not been willing to live out the call, to be willing to step into the brokenness of people's lives and to say, you know what, no matter what, I'm going to care about you. I have somebody in my life that I know can transform your life, and let me share a little bit about my Jesus. And instead, again, we like our church services to be all happy, right? They got to have just these nice things that allow us to be comfortable. We got to have our church services wrapped up in this little box with this nice bow so we feel good about ourselves. But friends, when we walk into the broken areas of people's lives, that's not easy stuff. That's tough. But as we do that, I guarantee you that as we're willing to step into the brokenness, guess what? People will be healed. People's lives will be transformed when we're willing to journey and walk alongside them. But we have to be willing to do that. Now again, friends, a lot of people, even myself, can get wrapped up in this idea that to see some of this, to see the power, means that we're only dealing with Jesus's miracles, right? The healing of the sick, the casting out of the demons, the resurrection of the dead. But friends, there's more to life in the kingdom than just the miraculous, although that's an important part of it. There's also taking on the character of Jesus Christ. It's also living and understanding the nature of God and seeing those things also produce fruit in our lives. And friends, I honestly believe that the more we return to our first love, the more that we remember what our purpose is as a church, and go back to making sure our lives are aligned in Christ, and then doing the things that Jesus taught us to do, that we too will begin to attract people from all over the region, because they're going to look at us as a church and as a people and say, you know what, there's something different about them, and I want to be a part of what that is. And friends, I want to tell you, because I don't want you to make it think like I'm criticizing you or I'm all doom and gloom, I'm very excited about what I'm seeing in our churches right now, because I see shoots of life. I see coals being fanned, and I see revitalization beginning to happen. I see powerful transformation taking part in your lives, and as a result, other people's lives are being changed because of that. Even this last Lenten series that we did, I was blessed beyond belief to see the way that you came together in a spirit of connection and community, right? Not in the 6 years that I have been here have I seen the connection and unity that I've seen amongst our two churches. And yet you came together without a spirit of competitiveness. There wasn't complaining and grumbling because we had to serve and be hospitable to each other. We weren't complaining because we were doing another book study, Bible study. We were doing this. We weren't doing that. We came together and we enjoyed our time together. There was meaningful conversation at the fellowship and the hospitality that we shared with each other. And friends, I think one of the greatest things that happened during this last Lenten series was that we crossed the border in intergenerational worship. Now, on our part, we did hold our youth group captive for some of our Wednesday nights. We made them be there, but you know what? You adults, those of you that are older, created a space for those kids to step in and to share their lives with you. And I think that was very meaningful for them because they sat there and said, you know what, they honestly care about what we think. They're interested in the things that we have to say. They find the things that we have to say valuable. So thank you for creating that space. And at the same time, those kids blessed you because they did show you that they're not just a bunch of lazy people that don't want to work and aren't capable of any type of thought. Some of our kids showed you that they have pretty good foundation under their belts and that they're pretty powerful young men and young women. And friends, that to me is super exciting for us as a church. It's one of the benefits we have of being a small church is that we get that intergenerational worship. Because when you get to the big church, guess what? The kids generally get shipped off to their own services, their own youth pastors, their own curriculums. And then all of a sudden to try to reintegrate them back into adult worship is a very difficult thing. So friends, be blessed that right now as a small church, we get to pour into the lives of those young people and they get to pour into our lives. So again, I'm very excited about where God is taking us as a church. And I'm excited to see what the next few months look like. So live into this and let us follow the blueprint that Jesus sets, not just for ministry, but for life together. Life together with each other and life together with Jesus Christ. My friends, God bless. And amen. Now, friends, as I've given that message, there was a request this past week to coming out of Easter and coming out of Lent and some of the things that we've done to offer a reaffirmation of our faith. And I think that that's very appropriate to think about the things that we truly believe and to say going forward, yes, I reaffirm those vows. I reaffirm those things, the beliefs that I have and the commitments that I've made. So friends, we are going to, in just a moment, we are going to go through the Apostles' Creed, right? It's a statement of faith, a creedal announcement of the things that we declare to be true. And I'm also trying to look just very quickly for one other thing, so please bear with me. I also want you to consider the vows that you made to this church, right? Because when all of you came into membership, for those of you that have professed membership in the church. And I believe even if you haven't professed membership to this specific United Methodist Church, it's still a vow that you should take, and that is to serve the church faithfully, to participate in its ministries through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service. So friends, today let us go through this and reaffirm our faith and reaffirm our desire to live and to follow the teachings that Jesus has offered us. My friends, please join in. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, with that reaffirmation, I invite us into a time of prayer, and I would ask if there are anything that you would like to lift up and share with us, either prayer requests that you have or good things that are happening in your life. Colin?
Yesterday, I lost my tooth.
All right, so you lost a tooth, huh? All right. Trajan?
Yesterday, I got to celebrate my birthday.
Darn Grandma and Grandpa spoiling you guys, I tell ya. Well, congratulations on those fun things that are going on in your life. Anybody else? Cashton.
Our grandpa's feeling better.
Good. All right, so we're glad he's feeling better, but we're going to also continue to pray for him that he just keeps getting better, right? Keeps recovering. Judah. Okay. So congratulations on that accomplishment. All right. So you got to enjoy some of God's beautiful creation on a walk. Awesome. Sarah. So Holy Spirit encounters for all of you that will be participating in that conference in one way or another.
We've been praying for my sister Linda, and she's on a new medication now, and she's doing wonderfully, wonderfully well. And I praise the Lord for that.
Well, praise God that that is working for her. So thank you for sharing that. Anything? Karen.
For my brother Eric, who's dealing with the side effects.
So continued prayers for Karin's brother, Eric, as he dealing with some side effects of the chemo treatments as well as the continuing cancer that he has. So prayers of healing for him. You got to go to an ice skating show? Nice. All right. Anything else this morning? Well, friends, I'm going to invite you to take these things or anything else that may be on your heart and mind in a moment of silent prayer. For all that you're doing in our lives. And Lord, we thank you that your son Jesus has given us a blueprint for what it looks like to do ministry and to do life. And so Lord, in those and for those things and in those areas that we need to offer ourselves up for repentance, Lord, we submit and we willingly do that, that we might realign ourselves with your goals and with your principles and values that you have for each and every one of us. And Lord, we pray that we would do that important ministry, that we would share the invitation to your kingdom with all people, that they might understand the forgiveness that is available for the redemption and the healing that is available to them, as well as the salvation that they can spend eternity with you. Lord, help us to continue to find ways to disciple and apprentice people, and to do life with each other. And Lord, we continue to pray for the Holy Spirit's empowerment in our lives and in our church to do the great work and ministry and mission that you call us to do. Lord, this day you have heard the many good things that are going on in the life of our church and in individual lives, and we thank you and we praise you for each and every one of those things. And Lord, we pray for those people that are in need of care, and so we continue to pray your healing power over and through people like Lisa and Eric. Lord, we just pray that your healing power flow over them, that their cancer would be healed, that their lives would be restored, that treatments would go well and that side effects would be reduced and minimalized. And Lord, we pray for continued support for family and friends to come around them and to love on them. And Lord, give them peace. Give them strength. Lord, we pray for those that will be going to the conference, whether it is digitally or in person. And Lord, we just pray for an amazing experience. Lord, that their hearts and minds would just be changed in such a dramatic way that as we interact with them, the next time we see them, that we can just tell that something amazing and something different has happened. So, Lord, just bless them in their time and minister to them. Lord, we ask all these things in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, at this time, I am going to invite us to join together in the sacrament of Holy Communion. And as I prepare the elements, I remind you that in the United Methodist Church, we have an open table, and that means that anyone who loves God is able to participate in this sacrament with us. Please know that we serve grape juice and not wine for those for whom that is an issue. Friends, if you would like to follow along in your hymnal, you can do so beginning on page 12, or you can follow along, and most of the liturgy will be on the screens as well. So friends, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love, and we have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And with your people on earth and all of the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water in the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, he gave thanks to you, and then he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. My friends, will you please join me in our Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Can I please have a couple of the acolytes come back up and help me serve?
My friends, the table has been prepared. Please come. Has everyone received both elements? My friends, the body of Christ given for you. Amen. The blood of Christ given for you. Amen. Friends, I'm going to invite you to stand for our closing song this morning. O Master, let me walk with thee. It is number 430 in your hymnal, or the words will be on the screen. We will sing the first two verses together. Please stand if you can comfortably do so. My friends, go forth shining with the light of Christ. Proclaim the gospel to everyone you meet. Disciple others. Feed the poor. Heal the sick. Cast out the demons and raise the dead. Amen. God bless. Have a wonderful day.